we talk about white noise, Johnson noise, more accurate, it's a better name for it because we know it's not quite exactly white. It does, the power spectral density goes down at high frequency. But there are other sources of noise that are not necessarily related to the thermal properties of the thing. One of these sources, which is very important in the circuit, is shot noise. Now, shot noise occurs when you have a system in which there are distinct transition effects of charge carriers. So a very simple example, you know, think about it, a p-n junction. Or, like, even simpler than that, if you have two plates, a parallel plate capacitor, like in a vacuum tube, and then you have electrons going from one side to the other. So either an electron goes through or it doesn't. We can't have half of an electron go through the system. The same thing in a junction, right? If you have a p-n junction, either you have an electron going to the other side of the junction, or it's bounced. You can't have half of the electron going in the other half, or two-thirds of the electron going through and one-half, one-third of it remaining back, right? So you have very distinct transition events. And I'll talk a little about how you can tell whether or not this exists in a second. But if you do have things like that, think about the current. What is carrying current? The current is really coming by these charges. These are negatively charged particles, electrons in this case. Or you can have both electrons and holes in a p-n junction transition. So your current is really formed by these impulses of charge, right? So you have like charge, and some of every so often. So on the average, if you look at an low-pass version of this in time, which is what you actually see, that you can see some fluctuations around your nominal value. So if your IDC is here, you will see fluctuations because every so often you will have a few more, a few less, and this is basically, this by itself is a Poisson process for the more mathematically defined. So you can see that the charge carriers going through are basically introducing fluctuation, the fact that the charge carriers are quantized themselves. Now, let me ask you this question. The size of these fluctuations, or let's say the variations of this, the power of these fluctuations, would you expect them to depend on the current itself? So if I were carrying no current, would you see any fluctuations? No, right? Now, the more current that I carry, if I had very little current, then I would expect to see less fluctuation itself by itself. So the more the current, the more the fluctuations. So it shouldn't be surprising if I say the power spectral density of shock noise should be proportional to the DC current. Because it's carried by the charge carriers themselves, right? The less the charge, the current, the less the fluctuations in the current. So that's one thing. Now, let me ask you this question. So now, what are charge carriers? They are electrons, or holes and electrons combined. What is the charge of an electron? Q, which is 1.6, 10 to the minus 19. Okay. So now, what if your charge carriers were, instead of, let's say, the electronic charge, instead of being 10 to the, on the order of 10 to the minus 19 coulomb, they were like 1 coulomb. We would live in a very different world, but let's just entertain that notion for a second. Do you think you will get more noise or less noise?
More noise.
More noise, right? Because think about it, if I'm carrying like a milliamp, it means that I would be, it would be very, very quiet for a very long time, and then every so often I get just like this huge amount of charge, 1 coulomb, goes through every like approximately 1,000 seconds. So every 20 minutes or so, just, there's just like this huge impulse of charge, and then the rest of the time it's just like quiet, nothing's happening. Boom! Right? That's much noisier than. And if the charge quantum was much smaller than 10 to the minus 19, you would probably expect to see less fluctuation, right? Because it's like more granular, smaller granular, more closer to a continuum. Okay. So it shouldn't surprise you to see this. Does it make sense? Based on physical argument. And, well, this shouldn't surprise you that much either. What made that this would surprise you? I mean, the easiest way to see this is that this is a double sideband spectrum. If you had a double sideband spectrum, this is a single sideband spectrum. If you had a double sideband spectrum, which basically it would be, if you were going from minus infinity to plus infinity, it would be simply QIDC, and then you're flipping over, so you get 2QIDC. This is what you're looking at. So you can see you can arrive at a lot of these things by just making the right physical argument. Now, if you look at a the exponent you know is 1. Because you basically your power increases with the curve. This one I agree with you, you may not know what the exponent is. So I didn't prove this. You can actually prove this based on the Poisson process. If you assume that the area of each one of these guys is cubed, and this is a Poisson process, you can easily determine the autocorrelation function. And from that you will determine the transfer, actually the exact power spectral density. So the power spectral density is, you can easily show it to be that. I can give you the references. I'm just skipping the derivation. But now, the bottom line is that it's determined by the charge carrier, the things that the size of the charge carrier, and the total charge transfer per second, the current. Those are the things to remember. Now, shock noise is interesting because basically the fact that you have quantized charge carriers, but you don't see it everywhere. And in terms of power spectral density, when you do the autocorrelation function and calculate the power spectral density, what you see that it actually sinks squared. And this happens at 1 over tau 1, which is the transit time, which is approximately on the order of time that it takes for charge to transit through the region of interest. So the time scales of interest are on the order of transit time. And the reason, the way to find out is that this would happen if the transition was happening through an infinitely thin plane. If you had transitioned through infinitely thin planes, you would have had a series of impulses. But now, if you have something that you have two plates, it takes some time for charge to go from one side to the other, right? So while it's in that transit, it's really, you can't represent the current like that. You have to represent the current as like these. And this time duration is the transit time. And to see how that works out, you can generate this sequence, the red sequence, out of the black sequence, convolving that sequence in time domain with this guy. Or let's make it simpler. Let's make it more interesting. So this guy. Now in time domain, they are convolved. In frequency domain, if you just look at the frequency domain, you have to take the Fourier transform. So it's a multiplication of the power spectrum of this and the power spectrum of this. The power spectrum of that is something simple. It's just basically, then this guy comes and scales it. The power spectrum of this thing is that thing squared. So it gets multiplied by the impulse train kind of thing. So you basically have like a power spectrum scaled by the sig squared function. And that's why this is on the order of 1 over tau, which is a transit time, the time it takes to go from one side to the other on the average. Now, you may say, okay, wait a second. You said that you have an injunction capacity in a p-n junction, whenever you have a forward bias conjunction, or reverse bias junction, doesn't matter. But anyway, you can have distinction, or like parallel plane. But your charge quantum is always, I mean, your charge is always quantized, isn't it? Is it a wire? Why doesn't a wire show shock noise? Actually, it doesn't. The wire does not show shock noise. The resistor does not show shock noise. A p-n junction shows shock noise. A capacitor, like a parallel plate, like vacuum tube, does show shock noise. But the resistor, a wire, does not show shock noise. Why?
She needs a curve.
Barriers?
Yeah, but that's what I said. So why do you need a barrier? I mean, what is physically different when you have a barrier and you don't have a barrier?
The mediums and work functions.
Say again?
The mediums that you travel through and the work functions. Yeah.
It's not related to the work function. It's actually simpler than that in a sense. So why is it? Let's focus on the question of, let's think about a wire. Piece of wire. The wire is continuous. Okay, sure. But how would that, so basically not to have shock noise, you basically have to be able to transfer charge will not have shot noise. It should be independent of the size of the charge. So it should be valid even for a huge charge quantum. That statement, right? So basically, you should not have individual transfer of charge. What is different, by the way? Let me think about it. Can I get quantities of charge transferred through the wire? Let's say you have, like, think about one plate in the wire. So this is the wire. And think about a cross section somewhere. This plane coming and crossing this wire. Can I have units of, let's say, less than a Q, less than an electronic charge go through this in a wire? Yes. I can have net charge transfer, that's any amount, like infinitesimal, one thousandth of an electronic charge, 1 millionth of an electronic charge, any fraction of it that you want. Why? Because the charge transfer in the wire happens by, what is the net charge transfer? The net charge transfer is determined by the overall charge of this thing. So there's this electronic gas, you have basically just electrons everywhere, and all it takes for a little change in the conformation to have a little bit more charge on that side than this side. Since you have a lot of charges that can move arbitrarily at any amount, you can have any amount of them. You're not limited by a distinct event. So the charge conformation can change a little bit, and that will correspond to a little bit more charge on the other side or a little less charge on the other side. That's what's physically different between a wire and a junction. In a junction, you either pass the junction or you don't. Doesn't matter how much you change the conformation of charge on this side. The number of electrons that have passed are an integer number. So that's why this distinct event, some distinct transit event, is what makes it possible to have shot noise. And that's the criteria that you use to determine whether or not you have shot noise. Right. Any questions on that? The other source of noise that we encounter in electronic circuits is called the popcorn noise sometimes, or burst noise, because it sounds like burst or popcorn. By the way, if you listen to white noise, like Johnson noise, it sounds like a If you listen to shock noise, it's more or less similar depending on how the frequency range you listen to. It's slightly different in the sense that some people can handle different things, okay, this is more like more distinctness, but I don't think that's true. I think it sounds pretty much more or less like a shock. From an audio perspective, it sounds like thunder noise. But burst noise is very different. You can actually hear like sometimes the old amplifiers, you probably heard this ticking sound. If you put the volume all the way up, you hear this like sounds like ticking. And that's basically caused by having trap sites, energy traps, inside the semiconductor. So you can have basically, these are the energy band diagram. But you can have these discrete levels due to impurities in the system, or crystal imperfections. And what happens is that these guys trap electrons, and then they release them at some arbitrary time. So as this happens, then you can basically create noise. Now, if you have one dominant set of traps with a given time constant tau 1, what happens is that they constantly take the electrons and release them over time constants of tau 1. So that corresponds to an autocorrelation function, which looks like this. So it's like that. This is the autocorrelation function. And if you look at the power spectral density of something like this, the Fourier transform of that comes to 4 r x of 0 divided by 1 plus tau 1 omega.
The
physical origin is that, think about it, that there are these traps. inside the semiconductor that every so often they capture an electron, hold on to it at random time on the order of tau 1. It's a relaxation process, it's a time constant tau 1. So they hold on to the electrons for tau 1 and then they release it. So there's a fluctuation in the current because of that. Now, if all of these traps are of the same nature, they're caused, let's say, one of the things that used to generate, used to cause this in the old times, nowadays, of course, they have enough purities enough for this not to be the problem, are heavy metal ions. If you have heavy metal ions in the semiconductor, they create these trap sites, trap level, energy levels, that have a fixed constant, and that's what basically caused those ticking sound, this popcorn sound in the old amplifiers. And the new ones don't hear it anymore, because they purify, they have much more pure semiconductor to work with. But now, those basically catch and release is like an exponential decay kind of thing, right? So it's a first order relaxation process, which will have this kind of autocorrelation function, which corresponds to this kind of power spectral density. And this power spectral density, if you look at the power spectral density of this noise, it's like a low pass, first order low pass system, with a time constant on the order of 1 over tau. Yes?
What does it look like in time domain? Is it periodic, the period of tau 1 or something?
Depends. In time domain, it can look different ways. In the old times, when they had like this dominant, single dominant not impurity with this given time constant, it basically looked like this. But it can look in many different ways. It doesn't have to look like that. There are different ways it can look, process like that. So there's no distinct shape in time. But definitely it sounds very different. You can hear it's like very distinct, more distinct events. It's called popcorn noise, but it sounds like making popcorns. Okay? So there's another source of noise, which is very important. And they're interesting. In fact, it's so interesting that these phenomena, one of our F phenomena, there are conferences dedicated to these. The people who specialize just in studying these. And one of the interesting things about it is that one of our F noise, or flicker noise, we call it flicker noise, is an interesting noise in the sense that its power spectral density is approximately 1 over F. Versus frequency. Now, this is not an integration. An integration doesn't give you this. Because you remember, integration gives you 1 over f squared. Because the transfer function magnitude squared gives you the transfer function. So if you take white noise and integrate it, you get 1 over f squared, not 1 over f. More like this. This is f squared. Now, this is very interesting because it really comes from something that's called the power laws. Power laws are interesting. So basically, it says that many events don't follow the Gaussian distribution, they follow the power law, which basically means that the number or frequency of the number of events and the size of the event, if you look at the size of the event and the number of events, so there are lots of events of small size and smaller number of events of large size. So again, example, which is completely different. There are a lot of things in nature follow power laws. And on a log-log plot, then this would be a straight line, so it means that it's like a power. So example is the size of the asteroids, or meteors, that hit Earth, and their frequencies. The frequency, the number of earthquakes, and their size. Think about it. How many magnitude 8s do we see? How often do we see magnitude 8 earthquakes? For a given time, right? Let's say in your lifetime. How many are so far?
Zero.
Zero.
Many experience?
Yeah, or have heard about. Right? How about magnitude 9s?
One or two.
No, but they exist. They happen. They're very infrequent. Right? So it's kind of like this whole thing. So if you actually look, if you actually plot, but there are lots and lots and lots of like magnitude 3s and magnitude 4s that are happening constantly. So if you actually plot the frequency, the number of times they occur over a time period, versus their They follow a straight line on a log log plot, which means that they are like based on power. They are not a Gaussian distribution. So a lot of things like that. The stock market is like that, actually. If you think about the size of fluctuations, the huge increases and huge decreases, or like changes, crashes, you get very few big crashes. Everyone knows about them, but they don't happen very often. The more smaller fluctuations, you get a lot more smaller fluctuations. But if you even plot them, you get the same thing. Now, it's interesting. If you have events that follow the parallel, in other words, their number is inversely proportional to tau. So let's put it this way. So their number is inversely proportional to their size. Then you get something interesting. You get a one-order F behavior. And we'll see why in a second. So in the case of semiconductors, now let's say instead of having one kind of dominant imperfections or impurity or traps can be caused by a lot of things. Even if you have a pure set piece of semiconductor, there could be small crystal dislocation, there could be these small changes. And you can imagine that there are a lot of little problems, and there are fewer larger problems, and yet fewer major problems in a crystal, or fewer bigger imperfections. So if you think about it, if you think about the number of traps, and let's say we have a lot of traps with very small time constants, because the small time constants will not affect you very much, right? They capture the electron, release it very quickly. Catch it, release it quickly. So these are less effective. So we will have a lot of these. So let's say the number of traps is an inverse function of the size of the time constant. So you have very few traps with very large time constants, and you have an inverse proportionality with time constants. If you just assume that, you can derive the 1 over f behavior, and this is how it's done. So each one of these traps will have a spectrum that looks like that. But they are scaled by their number, right? Their significance. So these guys, let's say 4, rxx0, tau1 over 1 plus tau1 omega squared. Now, this guy, we know that how many of this kind of trap with the time constant tau1 we get? Approximately some constant b over tau1, right? That's the frequency of that thing happening. So you have to integrate this over all the traps. Time constants. So basically, you're adding these different time constants. So you say, okay, I'm adding these different power spectrums. So I have a whole bunch of traps like this, and I have smaller traps like that, and like that, and like that. So this is basically the power spectrum density. Now, if I calculate this integral, basically I see this tau cancels that, and then there's some constants, so 4brx squared. So let's call this constant c, integral from 0 to infinity d tau over 1 plus tau 1 omega squared. Right? I need to change a variable. So this is an integral over tau. So omega is a constant. So I can multiply and divide by omega. And this becomes, if this is u, this becomes du. So this becomes an integral from 0 to infinity du over 1 plus u squared. C over omega. And this is, we already calculated, this is pi over 2. Inverse tangent, so it doesn't matter. So it's like pi over 2 times c, so you get another constant, d over omega 1. So this is the power spectrum of the overall system, the sum of all this power spectrum. And what you see is this, that the sum of all these individual low-pass power spectra gives you something that's 1 over f. And it's interesting, if you take a sample of this stock market from value of stock market over a very long period of time, and look at its Fourier transform, you see the 1 over f. You see this almost everywhere. There are lots of places where you have this kind of behavior. And this is one of the interesting things. Now, in physical systems, in circuits, we also have 1 over f noise and flicker noise. And we'll talk about next time when we talk about the device, the sources of noise inside the transistors and the devices. Then we'll see where it comes from, how it's modeled, and how we calculate things based on that. So there are several first sources of noises that we talk about. And we derive the white noise, Johnson noise, for the resistor for basic principles. And then we also looked at shock noise, burst noise, and flicker noise. And there are other sources of noise that we can talk about as we go along, but they're less important than the circuits. Any questions?